Find the Way as we celebrate Canada's birthday on this July weekend. This has to be one of the greatest countries to live in.
Ashley, I'm all for that. I just love Canada. As I travel throughout the world, I can't wait to get back. The freedom that we have here, the things that we enjoy, from healthcare to the changing climates to things like hockey that make this such a great nation, and Tim Hortons. And I just love rubbing that into my friends in the States. But hey, you're not really Canadian if you don't understand what Tim Hortons is, if you don't play hockey, and if you have never been to Canadian Tire. I mean, those are the things that make us Canadian.
Yeah, that's what we're founded on right there.
What are you going to do on the long weekend? What are you going to do for fun?
Well, you know, you got to dress in red, run around maybe, and have a good time, wear some streamers in your hair.
Yeah,
show some support.
I don't know if I'm going to do that. Hopefully, I'm going to get a ride in the motorcycle, and somewhere I got to get a hamburger, a hot dog, and enjoy the barbecue, and just to be with the family and friends. Those things are really important.
You know, it's been fun learning some things about the country and just reflecting on this holiday that we're celebrating. And actually, I found out some things that I didn't realize, and you helped to unpack it even more. But that our country is founded on the word of God.
I think that's what makes it so great. That's what makes it so great, is it found on the word of God. And so tell us about that, because I'm not sure everybody is aware of this one.
Well, even if you look at things like the name Dominion of Canada, the motto of Canada, "He shall have dominion from sea to sea." So that actually comes from Psalm 72. It's found in Canada's coat of arms as well.
That's amazing that it's recorded right there. It's out in front of everybody, the importance of God's word. Wow.
So here's a little bit more trivia. In 1866, the Fathers of Confederations, they were coming together to discuss the assembly of the provinces.
1866. Okay. The year of your birth. Okay. All right.
I look so good for that year of birth. But what happened was they came together, and there was a letter signed by John A. Macdonald, who was prime minister at that point, and he explained to Queen Victoria that the name was a tribute to the principles that they desired to uphold. That the last province to join Canada was Newfoundland, whose motto is, "Seek ye first the kingdom of God."
And that was taken from Matthew chapter 6, verse 33.
Yeah.
But amazing that Sir John A. wanted Queen Vic to realize that what they were upholding in this new country was based on scripture.
Exactly. You go and you look at the Parliament buildings, something I didn't realize about it when I was visiting. But when you walk in and you walk past the centennial flame on the front of the building, immediately you're drawn to the Peace Tower, which rises above the center block. And that's actually pointing to the heavens. And if you keep going through the front doors, your eyes are drawn upwards. And it's this Gothic artwork of vaulted arches. And it's quite amazing and something to see. If you walk into the Library of the Parliament, the oldest structure, the woodwork is remarkable. It has floral designs hand-carved directly into the wood. And it's actually said that no carvings are the same at all.
But what is happening when you go in there? It's all designed to make you look upwards, isn't it?
Yeah, that's exactly it, right? Like if you keep going through the different areas, it's all heaven-bound, actually, in its approach.
And it was designed to shape you so that it's almost as if you're in a posture of worship towards God as you're looking up.
And that's what's behind the Gothic architecture.
That's profound that was their one of their driving agendas.
And etched in the carvings and all throughout the Parliament building, there's a lot of different scriptures that are there.
So scripture was really important to the founding fathers of our country. And as we celebrate Canada Day, I think that we at least need to recognize that. I mean, one was over the east window where it says from Psalm 72, "He shall have dominion from sea to sea," the one that you talked about.
Mm-hmm. There's one in the west window where it says, "Where there is no vision, the people perish," which is from Proverbs.
And then over the south window, there was the one from Psalm 72 says, "Give the king thy judgment, O God, and your righteousness unto the king's son." So it's really kind of amazing. Those are just a few of the scriptures that are etched throughout the buildings. And in an age, Ashley, when it seems that there are no enduring legacies, the testimony of our forefathers endures through what they have written in the scriptures and where they've placed them in very visible places as reminders and memory tools. And that's why I thought that on the long weekend, I need to talk about the importance of God's word, because I'm not convinced that most people listening today, while they might give token, acknowledgement that, hey, the Bible's a good book, likely they haven't read it for a long time.
Yeah, and it's fitting. You were talking last week about Jesus, the Son of God, the Word, and that connection. And then looking to the scriptures to say, is this really truth? Is it true, like it says, that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life? So this all kind of ties together.
It really does tie together. And what I want to look at from the scriptures today as people are listening is how to have happiness and success. That's what we want for every Canadian. We want that for everyone in the world. But as we unpack that, we're going to discover on this Canada Day weekend that happiness and success are found as you understand God's word and let it shape your choices, your values, and who you are becoming.
This is going to be a great show. We invite you to engage and put your thinking cap on. If you have actually questions, send them our way to www.findtheway.faith.
Now, right now, we're going to listen to Keith and Kristen Geddes. They sing a song called Every Promise of Your Word, which is going to underscore things for what I'm going to share in just a moment.
From the breaking of the dawn to the setting of the sun, I will stand on every promise of your word. Words of power strong to say, that will never pass away. I will stand on every promise of your word. For your covenant is sure, and on this I am secure. I can stand on every promise of your word. Pressing in, I will stand on every promise of your word. You are faithful to forgive, that in freedom I might live. So I stand on every promise of your word. Guilt away. You remember sins no more. So I stand on every promise of your word.
Well, hey, I don't know anyone who'd not want to be successful. We want to be successful parents, successful students, athletes. We want to be the successful employee, and the list goes on. And it could be said that the world is also wanting to be led by successful leaders. Now, one such man lived about 3,000 years ago. His name was Joshua. He took over from Moses in the incredible task of leading the nation of Israel into the promised land. Hold that thought just for a moment. Remember another leader, Winston Churchill. He was asked by King George to form a government and lead Britain into war against the Germans. Churchill was recorded as saying, it was as though destiny had prepared him, and all that he had gone through was for that particular season of life. Now, this guy Joshua, jumping back, might have pondered something similar. After all, he'd been with Moses for the last 40 years in the wilderness, but the Bible says something a little different. Actually, the would-be leader was overwhelmed with the task, and the Lord actually gives him this word on how to be successful. And it's a word for you and I today. He said, Joshua, and we read it in the book that bears his namesake in the first chapter, verses 7 and 9, be strong and very courageous. Good words for leaders. And then he says, be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave to you. Don't turn from it to the right or the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. And do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful. Why careful? Because it is easy to do things that you think God wants, but really doesn't. Be careful to do everything that is written in the book. Then you'll be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Okay, that seems kind of clear to me. The Lord is saying that we're to have a high regard for his word. He tells Joshua that, follow the book. And we're not going to know what's in the book if we don't read the book. So Ashley, I just want to give a little shout out and encouragement to people who say that they are Christians, because I think you have a stat somewhere about how many Christians are actually reading the Bible right now.
Yeah,
what is that?
It's interesting. A Bible League Canada did a Bible engagement survey a couple of years ago, and only 14% of Christians are actually reading their Bible on a regular basis.
On a regular basis. Wow. So that's discouraging, but on the positive side, we can start to change that even today. If you want to be successful, we're going to see that in a few moments, you need to read God's word, because he describes in there the pathway for success and what it looks like. So he says to Joshua, he actually says, I want you to meditate on my word every day. Now, the Lord says that we're to have a high regard for his word, that we need to study and meditate. Now, meditating is like a cow that chews his cud. I've spent enough time around farms to know that when a cow eats, this is a little gross, he brings up his food and chews it over and over again. The cow is doing what is called meditating. He's chewing, he's mulling it over. And God said to Joshua, I want my word to be in your mind so much that you're mulling it over and over like a cow that chews its cud. Now, maybe we would be a lot more happy and contented if we actually were meditating on God's word, because it would help us to sort through things when we don't get the raise that we want, when we are dealing with a sickness that was totally unplanned for, and most sicknesses are. When something unexpected, the crisis, the tragedy happens, God says, if you dwell on my word, it will prepare you. My brother once said that the time to prepare for a crisis is before you're in it. Okay, we've said all that. As you're listening, let's just change gears for a moment, and I want to jump ahead now from the Old Testament to the New Testament to what Jesus said, because Jesus often said things that would make people sit up and take notice. Have you ever thought that his words had actually even greater impact than his miracles? For instance, on one occasion, he's talking to the religious leaders, the ones who prided themselves on knowing Scripture, and he had this to say. Jesus said, you are in error because you do not know the Scriptures or the power of God. I mean, they could have been saying, blah, 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 what are you talking about? We're the ones who know the Scriptures. We study them. But he says, you do not really know them. At the resurrection, he says, people will neither marry nor be given in marriage. They'll be like the angels in heaven. But about the resurrection of the dead, have you not read what God said to you? He said, I am the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, the God of Jacob. He is not the God of the dead, but of the living. And when the crowds heard this, they were astonished at his teaching. So see, what was happening is the religious leaders were misquoting the word of God. And if they were doing it in the days of Jesus, shouldn't that concern be with us as well? Ashley, how many times have you heard people say, yeah, I've read the Bible. Oh, yeah, I know what it says. Really? And they misquote it. They don't know what it says. The only way we're going to know what it says is if we study it and are able to apply it to the context that we're living in. The Apostle Paul wrote to his understudy Timothy, he said, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a workman who is not ashamed, who correctly handles the word of truth. And correctly handling the word of truth is a reference to how we read the Bible. Then he went on to say that all Scripture is God-breathed, and it's useful for teaching and rebuking and correcting and training in how to live a life that's righteous and holy. You know, there were times when I would read the Bible that I would just open it at random and pick a verse. And that was just crazy. That was like intellectual suicide. I came to one verse where it says, and Judas went out and hung himself. So I taken that out of context and I thought, well, God, that can't be your verse for me today. And I was a little shaken. So I tried another verse and it says, whatever you do, do it quickly. Well, I get the point. That's a little bit of a lame joke, but it's not totally untrue. People just crack open the Bible and say, I'm going to read a verse and see if God will speak to me. And that's not how we're to read the Bible. We're to read it systematically. We're to read it with knowledge, understanding why it's there and how it can shape our lives. And many times we come to God's word and we want advice or direction. And the good news is that his word is there for direction. But sometimes we treat God's word like a video. You see, whatever you store inside of you will leak out in times of testing, times of temptation, and times of trial. When I hit my thumb with a hammer as a preacher, I'm always intrigued at people around me who are wondering what I'm going to say at that moment. And what about when times of temptation come? I've learned that I need to be prepared for temptation. There's a bell that goes off inside of me that says, Mike, have you been giving time to read God's word and to pray? Because when temptation comes, I'm likely going to want to give into it, whether that's a lustful thought or a choice to do something wrong, thinking no one's going to see me. I need to remind myself that God is watching over me, that God is going to see me. I remember the great preacher Chuck Swindoll told a story of how he walked into an elevator and rode up. And on the elevator, there was a woman there who propositioned him. And he was tired. He'd been away from his wife traveling for a long time. And he thought, no one's going to know. It's not going to really matter. And then God's word, rang a bell in his mind. And it says, whatever you sow, that's what you're going to reap. And he realized that there would be consequences for the indiscretion of the moment. And so he made the right choice. And always we're dealing with temptation. What are we going to do in the moment? Likely many of you have had a problem. And the problem is that you've believed God is something that he isn't. And when that happens, it wrecks your life. And the second is that it makes God look like an idiot, at least to your friends. The author Donald Miller, and I know you like Donald Miller, Ashley, he talks about his growing up years. He said, when I was a kid, and to be perfectly honest, a teenager, and then he goes on and says, and maybe a young 20-something, I believed that God was like Santa Claus. I realize that grown-up people should not think God is like Santa Claus, but you wouldn't believe how perfectly convenient it was for me to subscribe to the idea. The benefits are astounding. First, to interact with Santa Claus, I did not have to maintain any sort of intimate relationship. Santa slipped in and out of the house. He left presents, ate half a cookie, and then he hit on the neighbor's house. There was no getting us out of bed in the middle of the night to have sloppy conversations about why I was still wetting the bed, Miller goes on. And then he said, the second is this, Santa theology was very black and white. You either made the list or you didn't. And if you didn't, it was because you were bad. Not because of some societal pressures or biochemical distortions or your parents or cable TV, but because you were bad. Simple indeed. And third, Santa brings presents based on behavior. If you were good, you got a lot of stuff. You got a lot of bank. And they're a very clear reward system based on the most basic desires of the human hearts. Big wheels, Hot Wheels, Legos. You didn't have to get into the spirit of anything. And there was nothing sentimental that served as the real reason for the season. Everyone knew that it was about the toys, cold, hard toys. And then he goes on, he says, fourth, kids who were bad got presents anyways, which was perfect, kind of like having a plan B. But he says, slowly everything began to unravel. And I tried to stop it because it was all so lovely and perfect, but there was nothing I could do. Truth grew in my mind like a fungus, and though I tried to keep it out, there was no resisting the epiphanies. Santa went first, then the Easter bunny, and then he says, for many people, it's God. And he says, truth will grow in our minds like a fungus unless we're studying the word of God. What a great pitch to have our minds filled with truth so that we know what we're believing, we know what is shaping us. Great preacher in New York City is a man by the name of Tim Keller. And I love his discourse on Psalm 1 because he doesn't talk so much about success as we just looked at with Joshua. And God said, you meditate on my word, you'll have success. But he talks about from Psalm 1, how Psalm 1 says, when you meditate on God's word, you will have happiness. Let me read to you for a moment because the word happiness is the word blessed. And he said, blessed or happy is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Happy is the person who doesn't stand in the way of sinners or sit in the seat of mockers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. Keller said that the modern age is characterized by an unparalleled scorn of the past. Modern age said that human realism and imperial investigation will do it. Well, how have we done? Are we making progress? Well, technology certainly has made things safer, and slavery has been almost abolished. But while our ancestors had no health benefits or vacations or appliances, yet are we really happier than our ancestors? If you read in their journals, do you see as much boredom and despair? We could probably make a case that things are not better. The Bible has always said that what makes you happy or unhappy are profoundly spiritual issues and choices. What does the Bible tell us about happiness and how to stay happy? Why is it even those who know this text are often unhappy? Actual Christians who claim to follow God. Maybe, just maybe, it's because they're not acting on the truths that are there. You see, Psalm 1 really is the gateway to the Bible. It's a text that tells us that happiness is possible. And if you don't think that this is a staggering concept today, then something really is wrong. Most of us start out thinking that happiness is natural. Life is tough. You better save your money. And the longer we live, the harder it is to find happiness. We find that the rich and those that appear to be happy are often the most cynical. If you don't believe me or the Bible, read Shakespeare or Hamlet, where everyone is dying sadly in the last scene. They struggle with the grand themes. Read the end of Hamlet. Life, he says, is a bleak shadow. You see, we start out thinking that happiness is natural and then wind up thinking that happiness is unachievable. And most of us are in the middle, migrating back and forth. And then there's, I guess, a fourth group, the ones who believe the Bible, that think that happiness is possible. Well, naturally, the human mind asks, if happiness is obtainable, why do so few have it? Why do so few have it? And I believe it's because of what we find here in the scripture. They seek it as the wrong way. They seek it in the wrong way because God's happiness is a fundamental happiness. Happiness is not a superficial happiness. It says that the tree is the person who delights on the law of the Lord will be like a tree planted by streams of water, which yields its fruit in season. His leaf does not wither, and whatever he does prospers. Let me explain that. God's happiness is a fundamental happiness. It's not a superficial happiness. The tree is subject to seasons, he describes. It's not always productive, but its roots have access to continual water. You see, the first major mistake is thinking that happiness is found in the externals. If you think that it is found in the externals, you and I are going to screw up. And then you will believe that it's found in what you have rather than who you are. The difference between men is always circumstances. The Bible continues to tell us that a Christian is someone who is rooted in something other than themselves. It says he is planted. Who did the planting? Well, the tree experiences affliction. It doesn't always bear fruit, yet its leaf does not wither. So now you have suffered grief, the Bible says. It's part of life to weep and mourn. And dryness is a season where the tree has to put its roots down deeper. Happiness is not superficial or joking around. It is joy that is stimulated, even by tragic circumstances. People, are you listening to me today? Put your roots down. Happiness is not brought about by controlling your environment, but by controlling your allegiances. And it can never be found directly. It's always and only a byproduct of seeking something more than happiness. If I know this, then why am I not happy? The Bible says, seek righteousness more than happiness, and you will get both. Hey, didn't Ashley mention that that was the scripture for the province of Newfoundland? Matthew 6:33, seek first the kingdom of God. As long as you seek happiness as your highest priority, you will lose. We often say that I believe in truth, telling integrity, honesty, but sometimes I have to choose differently to be happy. If you make a happy marriage your number one priority, you're never going to have it. If you make having a successful career your number one priority, you will never have it. The stress will kill you. And if you say that you will consider God so that you can get happiness, you're not coming to God. You're coming to a butler. The only way to come to God is without conditions. You can't come to God and think that he owes me a lot. The only way you know how you came to God is how you do in the bad seasons. And Ashley, as I wrap up right now, as we think about these thoughts of God's word of happiness and success, he invites us to come in the midst of the bad seasons of life, the hard seasons, and also the good seasons. But often it's the bad seasons where we discover that God truly is enough, that our joy is not just in circumstances. It's in knowing that we are loved by God for who we are, the children of God, that he wants to have a relationship with us, and that by trusting in him as a savior, our lives can be turned around and we can find a joy that can never, ever be taken away. And on this Canada Day, hey, that's what our country was built on. This amazing truth that God loves us and cares for us and longs to be in relationship with us.
Mike, I appreciate your message, and I agree with you, the importance of Scripture and the Word of God. But, you know, I could listen to your message and I could think, oh, that's another one of those, read your Bible, it's good for you. And for many Christians, they've spent their life, if they have read, reading because they feel guilty if they don't.
Ashley, thanks for raising that question. So here's what I would say to people listening today. If God's word seems dry to you, if you say, hey, where do I start? Look at this as reading a love letter from God to us. He wants to have relationship with us. And this is very simple. Some people are not going to believe it, but I know it's true. When you open up your Bible, say, Lord, would you speak to me through your spirit? He will do that. God's spirit will make it actually come alive. And understand where you're starting to read. I would say maybe start in the book of John. Maybe start in one of the letters in the New Testament that Paul wrote, talking about how to do the Christian life. That's a good place to start.
I think a lot of people, the other thing, and I've been guilty of this as well, is you pick up the Bible and you read it. You said, you talked about pointing it to a verse, so I'm going to read here. You don't get the context. Or we read it for advice, good advice. And what I've learned is the Bible isn't advice. It's actually news. It's the news that we've been saved, as we were talking about last week. It's the good news of actually what Jesus has done for us and for, and his love and his grace. And I find that when I read with that approach, it actually changes the way I look at all scripture. It's not just hammering me over the head with do better, be more. You're not really measuring up. It's look at what Jesus has done.
And it's good news because it tells us what happiness and success really look like. And it helps us to sort out the stuff. It's like a filter, because if everybody's throwing all the stuff at me every day about what I need to have to own it, buy it, you know, if I can enjoy it, then I'll be happy. Man, I'm going to lose. And God's word keeps coming back and saying, that's not what's going to make you happy. That's not what's going to make you successful.
Yeah. And so it comes back to Psalm 1, which you were talking about. I love that chapter, right? We have to come back to be renewed in who we really are and where our identity is. We have to come back so that we're like the tree that's planted by streams of water, that we don't go dry, that we always have that source. Our roots are firmly in place, but we don't get there unless we know the hope that we've been grounded in. So it's a powerful reminder, actually. The Word of God draws us closer to love, to grace, and to our true identity. And that's where we're ultimately, like you're saying, going to find success and happiness.
Ashley, the name of the program is called Find the Way. People can find us at findtheway.faith. One of the ways that we find the way is simply by saying, God, will you reveal yourself to me? And he is longing to do that today. So my invitation to all our listeners is to call out to God today and say, help me to enjoy you, to discover how much you love me.